What, how are we? As for me, when I took that, when I heard that line, I said I want to hear it again and again, because I know from where God brought me out. And I can never forget. And as long as I can remember that, I can walk every day of my life in humility, thanking God that today, wherever we are standing, it's only because of Him. Not our capacity, not our ability, nothing of us, only the Lord. Do you believe that?
Yes.
You know when you read that third line, only tears can come out and say, God, if it was not for you, we would have been dead or destroyed long time back, and our life was in a mess. It would be a total end, game over. But Jesus, you intervened at that time and turned it around, and you have made it so good. So good that, actually speaking, we feel like, oh God, is it a dream? Can we listen to that song again? And when we listen to this song, let's thank Him from where He has brought us out. And the best part is, He has not yet finished. It's getting better and better each day. And it's going to be awesome. Praise God. Yeah, just play that song, please.
So good.
how can I thank you?
How can I thank you? How can I thank you? How can I repay?
Can we repay?
No.
Never. Praise God. Hallelujah. And all that we can experience from Him is His kindness, His tenderness, and His constant presence. Even when I do wrong, His presence never leaves me. Let me say that again. Even when I do wrong, His presence never leaves me. Now you say, how do you prove that with the scripture? I can prove that with the scripture. God's presence never leaves us. We know that Adam and Eve committed sin. Even though they committed sin, God never abandoned them. He came in search of them. And He said, Adam, where are you? So God still comes in search of us, even when we make error, because He wants to still save us. He does not hate us, because in God there is no hatred. The only thing that He hates is the sin in us. Praise God. So He never abandons us. It is we, by our wrong understanding, our wrong teaching, we have been taught from childhood. I don't know about you, but I was taught that if I do wrong, God will punish me. Have you heard that?
Yes.
Hello?
Yes.
God never punishes His children. He only corrects His children. What's the difference between punishing and correcting? When you punish somebody, you lead that person to death. When you correct somebody, you lead that person from death to life. So God corrects us, and correction is going to be painful, it's going to be uncomfortable, but the result of that correction will be always great life. Praise God. So how can I repay you, Lord? Your kindness, your tenderness, and your constant presence is here with me. Praise God. Thank you. You made my day. I heard this song for the first time. In the evening, I want to play this song. Might be that time it did not touch me. Yeah, the same word might not touch you, but a day you hear the same word and it gets you like, ow, praise God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
So today we are going to study on love, connection. And the person who connects us with love connection, His name is Jesus. Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit. Okay. So Holy Spirit is here on this planet Earth. Jesus is there in heaven. And Jesus has said, I will send you a comforter. I will send you somebody to help you. Praise God. Hallelujah. So this person, Holy Spirit, is here with us. He is dwelling in each one of us. And He is God Almighty. And He has the solution for every situation of our life. And the best part is that He dwells inside of us. And so we can go to Him every moment and ask for solution. Hallelujah. He is a spirit of love. He teaches us to love. And what kind of love? He teaches us to love like God loves. Praise God. Before we go over there, a quick question. Are we children of God?
Yes.
Hello?
Yes.
So before we go on the love this thing, let's study whether we are truly children of God. Is that okay?
Yes.
Okay, Matthew chapter 5, verse number 38. You have heard that it has been said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I say to you, that you, please read that, verse number 39.
But I tell you, not to resist an evil person.
Not to resist an
evil.
What's your Bible say? What's your Bible say? Matthew 5, 38, 39.
But He resists not evil.
Oh, no. I'm stuck to that line. I can't go any further. Yeah, read that verse number 39.
39.
Okay. What is your Bible saying, Baba?
But now I
not take revenge on someone who wronged.
Okay, okay. What does your Bible say?
That he resists not evil, but...
Okay, okay. Just pause there. In other words, he's saying, if somebody is coming against you and doing evil, don't stop him. Are those alphabets in red? That means they are Jesus' alphabets. Hallelujah. Some Bibles have black and white, and some Bibles have black
and red.
Praise God. So what is in red is highlighted. So when you get a doctor's report, there are some things that come in red. That means extremely important. So in this Bible, there are some things that are in red, extremely important. What's the important part? If somebody is coming against you and doing evil to you, do not
resist.
What is Jesus talking, man? And we Christians always do that. See, when you are reading the line, I said, read 39. You read it and you went ahead. That should have knocked you off and said, Jesus, wait a minute, what are you saying? If somebody is doing evil to me, I don't stop him? He says, no. Let's read further. Are you interested in today's Bible class or you want to go home? The first line, and you're saying, hey, please, let me go home. I think I came to the wrong class. Hallelujah. Okay. That you resist not evil, but whosoever shall smite you on your right cheek, and if you are from Sri Lanka, then you turn to him and look at his two cheeks and beat him up at that very moment. What is he saying? When somebody strikes you on one cheek, so somebody strikes you on one cheek. Yeah! Does that mean? No. Allow him to strike you again. Now, in today's world, nobody strikes you physically, but surely they strike you with words. Like you both were sitting and having a good talk, okay? Then you went and somebody said, you know this lady, can I tell? You won't feel hurt, no? So now, somebody else spoke to her about her, she goes and tells, so each one is slapping each other, right? With words. Is it possible?
Yes.
See, I always find it difficult to preach in Sri Lanka because y'all never fight. You know, even when y'all fight, y'all talk in song. Hello, how are you? So even while fighting, you'll say, I will see you. So it's all in a singing, so it doesn't affect much. But in India, hey! Praise God. So if somebody smites you on one cheek, what do? So do we get a chance for somebody that is smiting you, insulting you, abusing you? Is there anybody doing anything wrong to you? Nobody. Let me pray for you. Hello, is there anybody doing that to you?
Yes.
So the first thing he says, don't stop it. Or don't stop her. Allow her to beat you. Okay, question. When Jesus' turn came, and when he was striked, did he allow the other cheek to be striked?
Yes.
Did he have the power to stop them?
Yes.
Did he have the power to destroy them?
Yes.
Did he use any of his power?
No.
What did he do? He allowed. Okay, go ahead and smite me. No problem. Then, oh Jesus, if any man will sue you at the law and takes away your coat, let him have your cloak as well. Then, whosoever shall compel you to go 1 mile, you go with him too. Has it ever occurred to you somebody is taking advantage of you?
Yes.
Somebody is using you?
Yes.
Come on.
Yes.
And here Jesus is saying, if somebody is using you 1 mile, You go with that person 2 miles. You say, that's enough. Come, I'll do more for you. When somebody takes advantage of you, do you feel happy or sad?
Sad.
I had the other day a lady who was crying on the phone. And she said, why are people taking advantage of me and using me and all those things? And then she said, you know, there's a Muslim family. She's a Christian, a Muslim family whom she has been helping, who the Muslims have taken loan. And this lady is paying installments from her business every month. And she's not even expecting a thank you. But these people are spoiling her name instead of paying a loan. I said, my God, you are doing much more than what the scripture is saying. Listen, the Bible says that they are supposed to do that to you. And when she read the scriptures, I said, listen, that gives an evidence that you're walking in love. Nobody liked it. She was depressed when she heard, when she read this word again and again and again. I said, praise God. Is it easy to pay somebody else's loan for years? And on top of that, they spoil their name. And on top of them, they call you and say, do you know, we never liked you. We are only using you. How do you like that? And I said, now what have you decided? Not to pay the loan? She said, no, I will still pay their loan because I made a commitment to them. So I said, then why are you crying? No, because they told me that they are using me and they don't love me. I said, are you paying the loan that they should love you? Uh-huh. You pay the loan, you are paying the loan because Jesus loves you. Hallelujah. You have heard it that, okay. Give to him that ask you, and from him that would borrow you of you, turn not him away. You have heard that it has been said that you love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, and pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you, that you may be what? So who is a child of God? A child of God is the one who practices all these things. Hello?
Yes.
A child of God, so that, see what he says, so that you may be the children of the Father which is in heaven. Why? For he makes his son to rise on the evil and on the good. So, does the Father say, okay, you have been extremely evil, my son, light will not come on you? Huh? And he sends rain on the just and on the unjust. Now the question is, our response to people is based on what? Their performance or our decision? Normally. Hello, normally how is our response to people?
Their performance.
I'll tell you, once there was a youth retreat, okay? And I was having my dinner and there were 4 youth girls who came to ask me some questions. And I was eating and I was answering them. And when I finished, they were all fighting for my plate. Not to take it home, to wash. Okay? So I looked at them and I said, I give you a guarantee. If you wash my plate, you will not even get 1 point. But there's a lady sitting behind you. She has got 3 children. 2 of them she's feeding, 1 in the arms. If you go and help her, okay? And do anything for her, God will see that and give you 100 points. Mostly whom do we want to serve? The man of God or somebody mean? Come on, let's be honest. Very good. You are very different. Where did you learn? Most of the time, whom do we want to serve? And actually, what is the Bible saying? A person who is a man of God should be what? A servant? Or should get service?
Servant.
So what should I be?
Servant.
And what should I expect? Are you following?
Yes.
See, that's why when somebody comes to pick my bag also, no, I feel very awkward. Hey, don't touch my bag. And if you want to tell, hold my bag and pick my bag, come everywhere where I'm going. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. So whom are you going to serve now? All the priests, the preachers will be angry. Hallelujah. Honestly speaking, if a person says, I am a child of God, then that person should imitate Christ who said, I have come to be served and not to serve. What? Yes! I who said it reverse. I said reverse. I said, I never you. I said not to be served. Not to serve, but to be served. And every you are not listening, not hearing. Praise God. So as a child of God, what am I supposed to be? So why am I annoyed when I'm serving at home? See, please understand. Whatever you do, always remember, you did not do it for anybody. You did it for Jesus. And when you finish the job, He looks at you and says, well done. So whether somebody said thank you or did not say thank you or did not even look at you, it doesn't matter. He said, well done. All the husbands will be happy with me now. They'll say, what did you teach, brother? My wife has become superwoman at home. And she's not even expecting a thank you from me now. Praise God. Just do it and see. You'll really, really enjoy. Okay. That you may be children of the Father. Then, verse number 46. For if you love them which love you, what reward have you? Do not even the publicans do the same? Can you read it? For if you love them which love you, what reward have you? Do not even the tax collector do the same? A question. Do you love those who love you? You are a tax collector. Yeah, you can sit here. The last will be first. Hello. Do we love those who love us? Then who are we? Sinners. Sinners. And if we love those who hate us, we are children of God. I like that. Did Jesus say that?
Yes.
Yeah, that's what He said. When somebody strikes you, turn the other cheek and love that person. Love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who persecute you. Now you are a child of God. But if you love those who love you, that's why you see these two people's love. Every Bible class that I come, they are both sitting together. Never separate. Loving those who love. Other people, at least they change their place. Same place. But thank God the neighbors are changing. But here the neighbors also don't change. So what is this? Child of God? Tax collectors. I never said that. Hallelujah. Then He says, if you love those who love you, there is no reward. There is no? Now how many times do you pray, God bless my finances? Do you pray?
Okay.
Let's say I am a businessman, you are a business lady, and I give you big contracts. And you are getting a commission on it. Now I come and say, I'm going to increase 5 more times. Will you be happy?
Yes.
Will you be happy?
Yes.
But you know, Christians will pray, God, please transfer the contractor. God, please talk to him. God, if you can't do, kill him. See, if I love those who hate me, I got reward. And if the person hates me more and I love him more, then the reward is more. So if the reward is more, why am I praying? God, transfer him. Why am I praying? God, bless me. Come on. There are so many blessings waiting for you, but your response should be what? Love. Nobody likes this formula. I don't know why. Is this what Jesus says?
Yes.
Yeah. So how many reward have we closed down? First thing, do you have at least one person who hates you?
Yes.
At least one person who troubles you?
Yes.
Thank God. So now you got one. Okay. Now, among all the people, whom should you love the most? The troublemaker. Why? The reward for you will be great. Because there will be two things that will happen. First thing, your nature will change, your character will change, you will become more like God. Why are you looking depressed? Thank you, Jesus. I'm giving them good news from the Bible, Lord. They don't like it. Preach on healing, brother. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Praise the Lord. Can you just close your eyes for a moment? And ask the Lord to help you love. Make that decision, Lord, I'm going to love this person. And you're going to help me. Your anointing is inside of me. You, Holy Spirit, you are already inside of me. I'm going to put this into practice, Lord. So that I experience more and more of you, I encounter more of you, I hear more of you, and I rise up from my fallen nature to your God kind of nature. Lord, all this time I've been praying to change that person. But today I realize, Lord, that you have put this person to change my nature and my character and develop and cultivate in me the nature of love. Father, thank you for showing me this truth. I know that I do not have the capacity and the ability to do it. But Holy Spirit, with your help, you are the helper. You are my comforter. With your help, I will surely be able to do it. And I thank you and I praise you for that. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Yeah? So please write down, why should I love my enemy? You want to know?
Yes.
Some points?
Yes.
First thing, who is your enemy? Can somebody say, who can be your enemy? Don't worry. You are single here. You can open your mouth. Okay, write down. My enemy can be a family member, a neighbor, a co-worker, a fellow citizen, government representative, just anyone, who does not like me. When I love my enemies, it blesses me, and transform my life. It truly makes this world a better place. Next paragraph. Why love our enemies? First one, to be like God. Matthew 5:45 and 48 says, to be sons of a Father in heaven, who is kind, who is kind to evil and unthankful men. So why should you love your enemy? Who is your enemy? Anyone who hurts you, anyone who does not like you. Right? Now why should you love that person? First of all, that you may be the child of God. And two, that you may develop the nature and character of the Father, who is kind to the evil and the unthankful. Praise God. Hallelujah. Are we kind to people who love us? Are we kind to people who hate us? What about you? You are more experienced than all of us. Not talking? She'll say, you ask me too many questions, I'm not coming from the next class. Why love our enemies? First one, to be like God. Second one, to be unlike sinners. Sinners love those who love them. Matthew 5:46-47 Luke 32:33 Same. To love those who love you, is it common? Come on. So it is a natural human nature to love those who love us. Now we got to come out of this human fallen nature to God's nature. So what would be that be? To love those who hate us. So the question is, Do you want to be a human or do you want to be like God? If you are a human, then you got all the selfish, greedy, jealousy and all the bad habits, bad nature. That's the natural fallen human nature. And here is Jesus saying, I want you to rise up from this human nature to God nature, and that God nature would be that you learn to love those who hate you. Okay, let me put it this way. No, you can talk. Now, I want to put it this way. In the early Christian time, there were people who got converted, right? Now, the conversion at that time and the conversion now, is it the same?
It's challenging.
Those days were challenging. And now? In those days, if a person had to become a Christian, he already knew that the world is supposed to hate them, torture them, persecute them, separate them, and even sometimes physically kill them. So their mind was already set that if I love Jesus, then I am willing to even die for my faith, but not be separated from Jesus. Now that was their mindset. In today's world, what is our mindset? If somebody hurts me in the Bible class, from next month, I will not come. Because that person showed me a big knife. What was that big knife? The person's tongue. And you got scared of the tongue and you don't want to come. The mindset has been changed so much because our understanding of Christianity is that when I become Christian, everything will become very good. I will have no more trouble. Actually speaking, when you become Christian, you get more troubles. But the good news is, in all these troubles, we have got a choice. Respond the world's way, or respond to Jesus' way. So if we really sincerely take the teachings of Jesus and apply them in our life, then those troubles are no longer troubling us, but we are troubling the troubles. Okay? Praise God. Hallelujah. So, we love those who love them, which is human nature, but we are to be partakers of divine nature. That is 2 Peter chapter 1 verse 4. How does a person become partaker of divine nature? We have studied it before. Come on. How does a person become partaker of the divine nature? Because the Bible says He has given us His great and precious promises, that through these promises we might become the partakers of His divine nature and escape from the corruption that is in this world through lust. So there are two things that will happen. One, we will be free from trouble. But before we can be free from trouble, the scriptures or the promises of God, when meditated and applied in action, will first of all change our divine nature. Change our human nature to divine nature. So the more and more we develop the human, develop the divine nature, the more and more we will find ourselves escaping from the corruption that is in this world. So you can take the scripture, speak the scripture, but not act on the scripture. You are still caught up in the corruption. You are not coming out. But you apply the scripture in your life. Now, first thing, your nature will change. The moment your nature is changed, the corruption that is coming against you will leave you and you will escape from that corruption. So do we use the scriptures to change our nature or do we use the scriptures to get a blessing? Hey, don't tell lies. Do we use the scriptures to get our nature change or do we use the scripture to get our blessings? Let's be honest. So God says, use the scripture first to change your nature. So it's like you went to the mall and you bought a dress. And when you were coming out, they said, hey, don't you know, when you bought this dress, there is a free one more dress for you. But you are saying, okay, I don't want this dress, give me that free dress. So most of the time we use the scripture to get that free dress. And God is saying, no, use the scripture first to change your nature. And how will the nature change? By changing your thinking. Now today we heard the Lord saying, if somebody is doing evil to you, resist not that person. So now when somebody is doing evil to you, will you resist? Will it hang? No, it will stop. Now you say, praise the Lord, my reward is on the way. Thank you. The test has begun, Lord. I'm supposed to not resist. I'm supposed to take all the beating and still say, God, give me the strength to love this person. Now you will be saying, is this possible in this world? Hello? Is this possible in this world? Okay, I'll put it this way. Has anybody of your loved one gone abroad to work? Yeah?
Yes.
Let's say that person went to the Middle East. Why do you think they went there? Because they love the sand. They love the desert.
More money.
Do you know how they work over there? We are so much better over here. They work like slaves. Okay? But when they come here to Colombo, hey, I've come from Dubai now. But if you see them there, they are miserable. Unless they are in a good position. Okay. Now, why are they ready to take all that pressure? Because they know after a month, they are going to get a big package. Right? In the same way here, God is saying, if you are willing to do this, the first thing that will happen is you'll become like me. Nobody got motivated here. You'll become like me. You'll have my presence go with you. Your nature, your character will change. People will see the glory of God on you. People can recognize you now that you're truly living His word. And truly you will see that there are bigger storms all around you and you're still at peace. And people will begin to wonder, hey, how can you be so peaceful, man? And they will say, hey, I also want to receive your Jesus who can give you peace in the midst of this storm. Hello. But in the midst of the storm, we don't apply the word. Will there be peace?
No.
Or pieces?
Pieces.
Ask your neighbor, what do you have? What are they saying? What are the two sisters saying? They love only those who love them. Now will you start loving me now? You see? Now they are saying, yes, we will start loving you. You saw? Now from today you are a child of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Praise the Lord. I wonder when they were small, how naughty they must have been. Okay, the third one. The first one, you become like God. The second, you are no longer like sinners. The third one, you overcome evil. You overcome evil. You do not let evil overcome you. You do not let evil overcome you. How do you stop evil overcoming you? When you hate somebody, evil has overcome you. When you love somebody, evil cannot overcome you, because you are no longer repaying evil for evil and insult for insult. So Romans 12 verse 20. Romans 12. Verse 20. And 21. Let's start with 19. Dearly beloved, avenge not yourself, but rather give place unto wrath. So don't take revenge. Don't fight back. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. So he said, you don't take the revenge. Hand over the case to God and let God deal with it. Praise God. How is God going to take vengeance? Aha, your next door neighbor is troubling you and you're saying, vengeance is not mine, it's of God, I'll see you. How will God repay that person who is troubling you? What? There is no question of vengeance. How is God going to deal with that person who is troubling you? Let me give an example. There's a man named Saul in the Bible who is going on killing the Christians. Okay? Everywhere he's going, the Christians are running for their life. Why? Saul has come to kill them. Now, vengeance is mine, says the Lord. How did God repay vengeance? He took Saul, opened his mind, gave him the understanding, and turned his direction. The very person who was coming against the Christian now became for the Christian and wrote 2/3 of the Bible. That is God's way of repaying the vengeance. Oh, is it? Then I will not give the God the chance. I will not take it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. How is our vengeance? See to it that is killed, completely destroyed. How is God's vengeance? The evil in that person is completely destroyed and that person becomes a blessing. Hallelujah. So, when we love our enemies, we are able to overcome every evil that comes against us. For if your enemy is hungry, give him poison. If he's thirsty, give him alcohol. For if so doing, you shall heap fire on his head. How many of you want fire on your enemy's head? So what does God say? When he's hungry, feed him. When he's thirsty, give him to drink. So the enemy will start wondering, this person, I treated him so badly, and look at this person treating me so good. That action of love makes that person restless, that he begins to change. The seed of love has got so much of power, it will destroy the seed, the tree of hatred. Because when a person operates in love, Satan has no defense against love, because God is love. So the more and more you make a decision to walk in love, Satan goes crazy. Hallelujah. And this ability to love has been put in every Christian the day we got born again. The power is in us, but our mind is not changed. Because every one of our action is based on knowledge. All this time we had a knowledge. The world said, she did this, you do this too. Teach her a good lesson. How do you teach her a good lesson? By feeding when she's hungry. By giving drink when she's thirsty. By going out and giving what she's lacking. are all this good news or the bad news? So why do you look at me as if I'm giving you a bad news? You know, one day you should come and stand here and see the faces. You know, when you're looking this side, you can't see, okay? You should stand here and when you're teaching, each one smiling, smiling, slowly, slowly. Depressing face, yeah? Huh?
How to start.
No, see how to start it? If you are saying, listen, the best part is the Holy Spirit is our teacher, right? And he is always ready to teach, he's always ready to comfort. All you got to do is point that finger there and say, God, Holy Spirit, you are my friend and you are in me and we are partners. I want to do this. Can you create a situation for me that I can get a chance to do this? And I tell you, he will teach you the Bible in your everyday life. The Bible should not be learned in a classroom. A Bible is learned in our everyday life. And the best part, for everything, training, you will always have training through people. God uses relationship to encounter him. So in our relationship, there is one person extremely nasty. You be extremely good and good and good. And the more you are becoming good, the more slapping you are getting. Praise God. Now the more slapping you are getting, the more spiritual muscles you are developing. And then the devil sees that you are actually using those wrong things to develop your new spiritual muscles, your new character. He begins to realize that he is actually being tormented. That's the time he leaves that person gets changed. How did Jesus win the match? Loving or hating?
Loving.
How did Jesus win the match? As a lion or as a lamb?
Lamb.
How do you think you will win the match? The world will say, you got to become a lion and you got to be so strong that when the person comes anywhere close to you, the person has to think twice before he opens his mouth because he should know who you are. And Jesus says, listen, I won over the world by being a lamb. If you want to be a lion, go and try yourself. Get beaten up and come back, bleeding all over. Still I will not abandon you, can still do it. This time, go as a lamb, ready to be sacrificed. Why do people raise a lamb? To be sacrificed. To be killed. Why do you become one to become a Christian? To be killed. To be sacrificed for Jesus. I hope they don't leave the church, Lord. All these words, to be sacrificed, to be killed, I better go back to from where I came. In other words, you are saying, you want to kill me, go ahead and kill me, but you cannot separate me from my Jesus. You can kill my body, but the very next moment, I am with Jesus. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you.
If you ask me, 33 years of my life with money, plenty of everything, and now the 16 years of my life. If you ask me, brother, which life are you enjoying? Without a doubt, this life. And especially from December, I'm studying all these topics, these ones, from December. And these have become my favorite topics. And I've been seeing these things. I'm saying, God, I want to do this. Can you help me? Can you give me a practice? My God, quickly the practice comes. From the time I've stepped into Colombo, I've been getting extreme bad news. And I was telling Gyan, and I was saying, Gyan, the test is extremely strong. Extremely bad news everywhere. And now the test is on. And in all this test, the Lord is saying, can you still walk in? Now do you think from the last 2 days I was going through extreme bad news when you saw me? Huh? Did I ask anybody pray for me? Why? Because I have a beautiful relationship with the Holy Spirit and He's helping me. And I will not go and tell the whole world pray for me. They might pray wrong and my life will become more miserable. I would rather go and talk to a person who has got faith, who can agree with me. You know, this, in WhatsApp, somebody is going, has got a heart problem, they'll put, this person is in a heart problem, let's shake the heavens and let's pray. So many of you, God, the prayers go wrong, the person is in a big mess. But you go to one person and the person is in faith. Jesus said, when two or three agree anything on earth, my Father will do it. You don't need 100,000 people. You need one person of faith who can stand with you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. So be not overcome of evil, but overcome evil with good. So when you love your enemies, are you able to overcome evil with good?
Yes.
Yes. Write down some statements of some people. And please learn them by heart, okay? Write it in capital letters, please. I will never let another man. I will never let another man ruin my life. I will never let another man ruin my life. How? By making me hate him. By making me hate him. Say that.
I will never let another man ruin my life by making me hate him.
That man or woman, okay? I will never let
another man ruin my life.
By making me
hate him.
So if you hate somebody, whose life is getting ruined? So what's the devil's job? To keep you away from God's blessing. You somebody will come and do kus 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 kus. Some people, their job is only this. In the church, kus 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 kus. And before, from kus 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 kus, some spice, some salt, pepper, all the ksh. Now this person is hitting that person. What has the devil done? Used a member of the church to cause problems. Even the dog barked at the same time. See? Okay, extremely sorry. Praise God. So hatred will bring destruction in a person's life. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Right on. Those who hate you. Those who hate you don't win. Those who hate you don't win unless you hate them. Those who hate you don't win unless you hate them. Those who hate you don't win unless you hate them. And then you destroy yourself. And then you destroy yourself. Can you check about Jesus with this? With this statement, can you check with Jesus? Can you check with Jesus? Did the Pharisees hate him?
Yes.
The scribes hate him?
Yes.
The world hated him?
Yes.
They crucified him? Did he hate them in return?
No.
What did he say on the cross? So did Jesus win?
Yes.
Could their hatred defeat him?
No.
Did he destroy himself?
No.
How do we destroy ourselves? When somebody hates us, we respond to that hate with our hatred, and that's how we destroy ourselves. Amen. Is it helping you?
Yes.
Next statement. Am I destroying my enemies? Am I destroying my enemies when I make friends of them? Am I not destroying my enemies when I make friends of them? Let me give an example. Supposing you are in a problem and I come to know, and I do something by which your problem got solved. Correct? I did it again and again and again. Now would you like to be my friend? If your problem gets solved.
Yes.
So if there is an enemy and you have got opportunity and you can solve that problem, praise God. What have you done? You have destroyed that enmity and turned into friendship. And when you ask God, Holy Spirit, how to do it, He will teach you. Nothing comes theory. It comes practical. But the question is, have I made a decision to act on the word? Now He will teach you how to do it. Praise God. Love is the only force. Love is the only force capable. Love is the only force capable of transforming an enemy into friend. Love is the only force capable of transforming an enemy into friend. So our ultimate goal should be to transform our enemies. So our ultimate goal should be to transform our enemies into brethren. So our ultimate goal should be to transform our enemies into brethren. So what should be our goal? To change our enemies into brothers in Christ. Normally what is our goal? As a human nature, what's the goal? I would love to see his life go miserable. Praise God. So what should be our goal now? To turn into brothers in Christ. Praise God. Next paragraph, how to love. You want to know? How to love your enemy. First one, by blessing them. Why? How? What's the meaning of blessing them? By speaking well of them. By speaking well to them. That's called blessing them. So what happens mostly? We speak well about people in front. But is there a tendency of speaking negative things that have happened, that you have experienced of somebody? See, a person is very good. But let's say one or two experiences you had which were not so good. Which one do you remember? You are the only one like that. How come you are like that? He only remember all the good things. How come you remember all the bad things? So strange. You ask everybody? We always remember only the good things of a person. So much time we have to remember what was that bad thing that he had done. And you can remember only the bad things?
You remember the bad thing better than the good thing.
That's what happens to you? So strange. Hallelujah. And many people will say, I got a bad memory. But those things, memory is very sharp. What about your memory? Huh? What did she say?
Fading.
You heard what she said about you? You heard? Sorry? That's what I said. She's not telling anything bad about you. Why did you jump to a conclusion? I just said, did you hear what she told about you? Quickly, she was saying, that means you are used to telling bad. That's why she said. This time she did not say anything bad about me. See, these are the things that happen. Come on, small things. And the small things become into a mountain. Praise God. So, blessing means what? Speaking well of and speaking well to. Praise God. Next one. By doing good to them. By doing good to them. Matthew 5:44. We just now learned about doing good to them in Romans chapter 5, what was that?
12.
No, burning coals.
12,
yes. So by doing good to them, which has the potential of transforming our enemies. Third one, by praying for them. Praying for them. So you become an intercessor for them and pray on their behalf for their good life and especially for a good encounter with Jesus. Praise God. So what are you doing? You are loving them. Fourth one. With active goodwill. Now, with active good and will. Now, normally our love is based on what? Emotions or will? On our response to people is based on what? Emotions or will?
Emotions.
Now, whenever it comes to God's kind of love that He's talking about, it is never based on emotion. You can have negative emotions in your mind, but yet you choose to operate on your will based on the word. So when it is God's kind of love, it's not based on affection. It's based on your choice to love anyway. See, when negative things happen, you will say, for me to operate and love this person, I don't feel like loving them. You understand? I don't even have feelings for this person. Now, God's word says, the love that God is talking about, Jesus is talking about, is not a love of affection, which is in the family, which is in the brothers, which is among the friends and all that. He's saying my love that I'm talking about is based on your choice to love. For example, when Jesus was on the cross, okay, and before going to the cross, was he in extreme agony? So before going he was in extreme agony, so what about him on the cross? Was he in extreme agony? Yes. Now he did not allow his feelings to love the people, but his decision to love them anyway. And that's why he could tell the Father, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they're doing. So in the same way, I can have a lot of negative emotions towards one person. But when I make a choice to do it because God's word says so, and I step out in faith and I act on it, now that act will be taken over by the love of God, and those negative emotions and affections will all be destroyed by my act of faith. Okay, I'll give you an example. There was this lady, the husband and the wife would come to drop me at the railway station every month. And every month, there would be a smile and we would have a lot of talking from the, when I finished the prayer, to the railway station. And this wife is hungry for God, passionate in love for God. The husband listens, but not like her. She's all the time prayerful and she wants to experience more and more of Jesus. So the husband began to speak to me and said, "Brother, is the Bible saying that I'm supposed to love everybody?" I said, "Yes. Including people who are extremely close to me and done wrong?" I said, "Yes." "So am I supposed to love my cousin's sister who is full of pride, who has lost her husband and now is in a mess?" I said, "Yes." So the wife said, "No, I'm not going to allow my husband to love her. She has insulted me. She is full of pride. She is very rich. She has got a lot of money and she wants to show her money and all this." And I said to her, "If you don't love her and forgive her for what she has done, then you are having fellowship with Satan, according to the word." So she kept quiet and the whole journey was absolute silence in the car. Not a word spoken, neither the husband is speaking, the wife is speaking, and I am also quiet. I got down, we are going to the train, all quiet, even the bye-bye is. And I told her, "Listen, your homework would be that you ask the Holy Spirit to help you to love this person. He will surely help you." She had tears in her eyes because of the bad memories and all that. They went back home, no talk, the whole day no talk. Now that one question of the husband had put them all both into a silent zone. After 4 days, he asked the wife, "Shall we go?" So the wife was now more broken than before. And he said, "I cannot go with you because when I look at you, your condition is too bad. And I want to tell you, I will not go to meet my cousin alone. I will wait for you. The day you are ready, we will go together." Now she is more depressed. So now she is asking the Holy Spirit, "I know it is wrong. I know what I'm doing is wrong. But can you please help me? I want to come out of this, but the past experience, this woman is so rich that she has been all the time showing her riches and all those things and insulting me and all those things. I just cannot stand." So she began to take that scripture and said, "Jesus, you said whatsoever you ask in prayer, first believe that you have received it and then it shall be yours. So I believe, Lord, that I have forgiven her. She has forgiven me. Our relationship is restored. Thank you, Lord." She began to say it the whole day. After about a week, The husband said, I see that you are looking much better than before. Shall we go? She did not say a word. She stepped into the car. Okay? Now the whole journey, both of them are not talking. She is looking outside the window. Tears rolling down. The husband is looking at the wife. Reaches the destination after 1 hour drive. Looks at the wife and says, let's go back. And now she opens her mouth and says, no, let's go in. So he says, are you sure? Look at your condition. She says, I'm absolutely sure. Let's go in. Now, he rings the bell. The cousin opens the door. Wishes the cousin, the husband, doesn't even look at the wife and walks. As if you are not welcome. The husband puts his arms around his wife and walks in. Okay, now both of them are sitting and the husband begins to share the testimony of how he got healed and how God has set him free and how the life is there. And he speaks his testimony for just 3 minutes. The wife takes over and she goes on and on and on and on for 3 hours. By the time the 3 hours are over, this lady is in her arms, both of them are weeping, both of them are kissing. And the whole journey is over. And when they are coming back, she hugs her husband and says, I never knew it would be so easy. Means what? Even when she entered the house, she was shown that you are not welcome here. Every gesture was, I don't need you. But when she began to speak about Jesus and how her life had changed, how her husband's life had changed, and this woman at a young age has become a widow, she began to listen, and the more she began to listen, the word of God changed her heart. Now what she was speaking for 1 or 2 weeks, by faith, our relationship is restored. God did exactly the same. But he did not show how he would do it, but he got the job done. Are you following?
Yes.
But every time the husband asked her, instead of retaliating, she submitted. Every emotion in her was saying no. I don't want to love her. I hate her. But the word of God said, no, you are supposed to love her. So she began to speak verbally, Lord, in your name, I love this sister-in-law of mine, and she loves me, and all of that. And I believe the Lord that relationship is restored, all that, by faith. So what she started with faith, faith got the job done. Are you understanding?
Yes.
If she had to wait for her feelings to change, I don't think so, it would have changed even till today. But when the other lady began to understand what she was speaking was life, her action changed her mind. So even now when I ask her, how's your love life? She said, if I could get victory there, I can get victory anywhere, she said. Hallelujah. And she said, brother, it's so easy. When I came back, I came to realize it was so easy. But before reaching there for 2 weeks, I was going through the torture. If God had to show me this is how he's going to do it, would have been so easy. And I said, that's what the Lord wants to tell us. He will never tempt us beyond our capacity. He will not put us on a trial beyond our capacity. He will give us only till how much we can take over. And the Holy Spirit is there to help us. Praise God. And she came back smiling, husband is happy, she is happy, and the best part, the cousin has received Christ and her life is changed as well. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Is this topic good?
Yes.
Yes?
Yes.
So, write down. We are not commanded. Active goodwill. Active goodwill. What is it? We are not commanded to love our enemies. With affection in our hearts. as we experience in families, friends, with brethren, we are commanded to love our enemies. We are commanded to love our enemies with an act of the will. With an act of the will. Displaying active goodwill, displaying active goodwill towards them. Blessing them, doing good to them, praying for them, however, where this kind of love is consistently shown, this kind of love is consistently shown, it is not unusual. It is not unusual for affectionate love to gradually develop. It is not unusual for affectionate love to gradually develop. And even if not, we still have the duty and privilege to be the sons of the Most High God. I remember years back, I was in those days not having chance to preach outside in the church. I had just started, okay, so I used to go to families and pray and have a small session. So I was in this lady's house and I was talking on the topic of forgiveness. I did not know what was her situation, absolutely having no idea about her life. I was teaching on forgiveness. I finished the topic and everybody left, and there were about two or three of us, and this lady came and said, "It's the topic is good but not practical." And I looked at her and I said, "What do you mean?" She said, "Listen, I can forgive everybody in this world, but two people I will never forgive. I will die but not forgive." I said, "Who are these two people?" And she said, "One is my husband and the other one is the lady who took my husband away from me. He's living with her. He left us when my children were in school, and it's been 7 years that I've raised up my children. Now they are in the college, but I hate him to the core." And I said, "Sister, if you hate him, the Bible says that you are going to hell. Because unless you forgive, the Father in heaven who wants to forgive you, he cannot forgive you. And if our sins are not forgiven, then we qualify to go to hell." And she said, "I don't care to go to hell, but I will not forgive him." So then she said, "Preacher, it's very easy for you to preach, okay? But it's not possible for anybody to forgive what my husband has done." I said, "Because you are thinking that you will forgive with your own strength. no human being can forgive, because the human nature is revenge. But Holy Spirit is there to help you to forgive. And I said it's very easy if you are willing to do it. She said, I do not even have a feeling to forgive. I said, listen, forgiveness is never based on feeling. Forgiveness is always a choice. It's a decision. And everything, even your faith, is not a feeling. It's a decision. It's belief. And I said, all that you have to do is tell the Lord that you are extremely angry with your husband, extremely angry with that woman, and you really don't want to forgive him, forgive them. But at the same time, tell the Lord, because I love you, I want to do it, but I can't. I don't know how to do it. I don't have the capacity to do it. If you can say that, he will take over. Are you willing to say that? She said, yes. So she made that prayer and she said that. And now then I said, now tell the Lord, on the cross when you hung, you are not God. You are man. And as a man, it's impossible to forgive those who have stripped you naked, beaten you up, crucified you, and yet you said, Jesus, you said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they are doing. The Bible says, the Holy Spirit was there with you all the time, so that you were strengthened at the time of your test. And that according to your word, the same Holy Spirit is in me. I too want to experience the same. So she began this prayer this way. I told her to say this. Father God, just as Jesus spoke those words, I also speak those words. But before you, I speak for them. I want to say, Lord, there are many things that I have done in my life which I need forgiveness. So please forgive me, because many a times I myself did not know what I was doing. And secondly, I choose to forgive them as a will. My feelings are still not to forgive them. But I still choose to forgive them because I love you and I want to continue in your love. She said that prayer and I said, keep on saying, Jesus, I love you. Thank you for giving me this grace. She went on. And after that, she never stopped. She went on and on and on, and she was weeping and weeping and weeping. It only stopped after about 25-30 minutes. And after 30 minutes, she said, I don't know what took over me. It was extremely strange. It was extremely different. I feel as if a big burden is gone. And I want to tell you, brother, what was not an affection has changed. I feel sorry for my husband. His mind has been blinded by this woman. And I said, if you feel that, don't you feel that your husband needs to be saved? This lady needs to be saved? She said, yes. So I said, pray for them. And I said, the Bible says in Hosea, that I think it is 4:6, I don't remember what's the scripture. It says that God told Hosea to marry a prostitute and to love her. He obeyed God and got married to this prostitute and began to love her. But she was not receiving his love. She would go back to her old lovers and have relationship there. And Hosea began to cry to God and say, God, you asked me to love this woman. I am loving this woman. But this woman is going away back to her lovers. And that's the time the Lord said to Hosea, I have put a hedge of thorns around her. A hedge of thorns around her. That from now on, she will want to go back to her lovers. But she will not be able to find them. She will not be able to go there. And I changed her heart and her mind. And now she will say, let me go to back to my husband. I said, you can take the same scripture and pray for your husband. And she said, okay. She must have prayed for 3 months. After 7 years, the husband called her and said, I want to meet you. Where can we meet? She said, where can we meet? Come home and meet. He said, are you sure? She said, yes. So he came home. She saw that the children were not there at that time. and he came back, came home, and he was sitting there. And she opened the door with a big smile and full of love and compassion. And he said to her that that woman had left him and gone with another man. So she said to him, "Listen, I'm not angry with you, but I'm feeling sorry for you. And here I am telling you that Jesus loves you, I love you too." So this man was shaken up and he said, "You mean to say you're not angry with me?" She said, "No, because Jesus in me does not allow me to be angry with you." So he said, "Can I come home?" She said, "Sure, you can come home." And the marriage was restored. The man was completely changed with Allah, began to go to church, began to change his life. The children were happy, the family was happy. And I said, "Pray for that lady that now when she has gone with the other man, she goes with this man permanently and gets married to the right person so that she doesn't keep on taking other people's husband." Praise God. Hallelujah. And that's the time this lady said, "All this time I was trying to forgive my husband, thinking, means I was hating my husband because I did not know the power to forgive, the power to love was already inside of me. I never knew that. It is through the scripture that I made up my mind. It was a choice. And her action to accept him just the way he is, like the prodigal son, when he came back, what happened? His life changed. All that the prodigal son did was to change his thinking. When his thinking changed, everything was restored. So also for this husband, everything was restored. Now if this lady had not the love of God, love of Christ, do you think this lady would have accepted him?
No.
7 years she struggled to bring the children up. She was working. Did not send a single rupee, nothing at all, just separated himself. But in spite of how he treated her, she treated him according to God's word. Now, did she have this intention in the beginning? No. She hated him to the core, was even willing to go to hell, but not forgive him. But when she took the word of God, that word of God who is alive and active, powerful, changed her mind. Changed the life and everything changed. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
Many of you are feeling hot. Tell your mind, it's pleasant. You'll feel absolutely pleasant. You know why I'm saying this? Because I change places. Now when I came here, I just came from Dubai directly. And in Dubai now, it's like if you stay out for half an hour, you'll become a dry fish. Okay, so there are times when I'm in a hot climate in the morning, by night I reach a destination which is extremely cold. So the body begins to get surprises. Okay, so the mind has been thought, no matter where you are, you're comfortable. Like when I went to Australia, they said, "The first day we will not have any meeting." I said, "What for?" "No, you will have jet lag." I said, "I don't get jet lag because where I am, my mind has to renew and I'm on the business." So I said, "The day I land, we will have the first session." They said, "Are you sure? You will be tired." I said, "I did not fly. I have to only sit there." I'm not a pilot that I'll get tired. The whole time I'm sitting there sleeping. So what tired? Some people get tired only while sitting. Have you noticed some people, if they have to travel from the Middle East to over here, they are all tired. Then you have to ask them, "Were you flying? What were you doing?" "Sitting." "And you're tired." Mindset. Change your mindset. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Right now, Is it okay?
Yes.
Are you enjoying this topic?
Yes.
I wish this was recorded. You know, the internet did not work. I wanted, that's why I was going behind again and again. What do you have thought? Every time I was going behind because the connection would come and the connection would go. This, I did not know that this is what God had planned. It was fantastic topic, isn't it?
Yes.
Something challenging to practice for the whole month.
Yes.
No, if you practice for 1 month, it becomes a habit. The stress is only 1 month. The stress is only for 1 month. You practice anything for 1 month, it becomes habit. What is habit? That comes naturally. So if you want to change your habit, practice it for only 1 month. Like people, like you all, what time you all get up? You get up at 4:35. Let's say the next day is a holiday. What time you'll get up? Why? I got used to it. So in the same way, when you get used to it, life becomes automatically used to it. Now you get used to it, when the devil knocks at your door, you say, oh, you don't. So now you're not worried about the devil. Because you got
used to it.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So how long you need to practice?
1 month.
1 month. Write down. Jesus said, you know, among all the classes in Colombo, when they watch me on the website, there are ladies who will say, the ladies' Bible class is the best class. Really? Yesterday one lady called me and said, brother, what is the topic for tomorrow? She is so excited to hear the ladies' Bible class because she says, yeah, there is a lot of fun. You teach the word, but all these ladies are full of life. They respond. But when you go in the evening, you have to ask question, nobody responds. See, this lady is from Muscat. She is watching. Okay, she was a lady who was in depression. Depression in the sense, she wanted to commit suicide. She would go into depression so much that she would take a knife and the person who was troubling her in the office, she would feel that he is in the room and she would talk to that and the husband would be watching. Who is she showing the knife? You can imagine. She would be so much in this that when she is frying the fish is there and the hand would go in the frying pan. Means her mind was controlled by so much of problems. Okay? And this lady got hooked up on the word of God. Never seen me, okay? Got onto the word of God, got onto the YouTube, and her life began to change. And one day she told her husband, I want to go and meet him. So the loving husband said, anything for you, darling. They drew from Muscat to Dubai, okay? At the check post, they were delayed for 2 hours. So she reached for the meeting when the meeting was over, and we were just going home, and she comes in. And she meets me and for no reason, I never ask people from where have you come. For this lady I said, from where have you come? And she says, from Muscat, from Oman. I said, why have you come from Oman to attend the meeting? And I said, the meeting got over. She said, yes, we got caught up at the check post. So when she said, I drew from Oman to Dubai to listen to God's word. I said, listen, I will come to Oman only for you. Because if you are hungry for the word of God, I don't mind coming only for one person. And that's how I started going to Oman for this lady. And now so many are blessed. So every day, she'll make it a point that whatever is being preached, she has to listen and all that. And then today morning, yesterday night she was saying, because when I went to Muscat, I found a youth, okay, a young girl. You know, her eyes are drooping, depressed and all that. And I said, listen, you are just like that. Come on. Here's a baby. She has got a future and she's in trouble. Nobody wants to touch her because she's boisterous, she's angry, she flings the plate out and all that at home. So I said, come on, God has given you this girl. Can you be a mother to her? She said, yes. So yesterday from work, she went to meet this girl. And she spent 2 hours with her. And she said, brother, all that I gave her was love. And when I gave her love, she would not leave me to come back home. She was holding my hand. And I promised her that I will go today as well. And she said, I never knew a small gesture can change somebody's life. Praise God. It was only on YouTube that she had seen. Then there was another person. This lady would hammer her husband for 35 years. Why are you laughing? Sorry? This husband would take the beating because he was in the Word of God. For 35 years, torturing her. And he would not speak a word. She would take a bag, pack all her goods and go. And after a few months, she would call him and say, I am forgiving you, okay? And I'm coming back home. He would say, please come. So we had an interview. If you can watch on the YouTube. The wife sharing her experience of 35 years, how she tortured her husband. And in the midst of all that, she was typing on the YouTube to get some teaching of all the people of the world. My teaching comes on, it opens up, and she begins to listen. Now the husband is in the Word of God, so she tells the husband, can you see this man what is talking? So the husband also sits and listens. And he says, fantastic teaching, you listen to him. And for 3 years, continuously, she's listening and listening and listening. And her whole life has changed. She's become a fantastic wife. And this time she told her husband, I want to go to Goa and meet this person. And that's how she came to Goa, all the way from Canada. And she said, brother, I want to share my 35 years of torture that I tortured my husband. Because all the time I believed that there was a problem with my husband. And after 35 years, I realized that I was the one. And she began to share how she would throw the tables, the chairs and all out, the saucers and all that. And the husband would be studying God's word. And he wrote a book on marriage. His book has gone to 120 countries. Challenge to Overcome. The name of the book is, he's saying, I'm an engineer. I tried with all my engineering skill to change her. And then I realized, God, this lady or any person can be changed by you because you are the creator. You got the formula. If you are willing to teach me the formula, I'm ready to go through. And that's when God began to teach him from the Word of God. And that's where he began to only develop love. No matter what you do to me, I will continue to love you. Even in that interview, you will find him so cool, so nicely talking. And this lady is now also in that fire. But she's now saying how miserable she was and how miserable she made her husband's life miserable. And she said, how wonderful was my mother-in-law. Even after when I would forgive my husband and I would come back, the mother-in-law and the son would be, husband would be waiting to welcome me home. She said, if I would have been married somewhere else, I would be a disaster. But they only kept on loving me. You should hear the testimony. The interview is for about 1.5 hours. It's amazing. Okay. Jesus said, if you love me, keep my commandments. Keep my commandments. Our obedience is proof that we love him. So when I say, Jesus, I love you, what's the proof? My obedience to the Word of God is my proof that I love Jesus. When we honor God, His Word is the superior. When we honor God, His Word is the superior and primary influence in our life. When we honor God, His word is the superior and primary
influence
in our life. So whose word influences you? Or in-law's words? Whose word influences you? Or somebody who has said something to you? All wonderful people. Hurting words don't influence you.
Useless.
Huh? You useless? Good for nothing? No, I'm not telling you. I'm just giving some of the words which you must have heard. Used to, not anymore. So now if it's not influencing you, has your life changed?
Yeah.
So when you honor God, the best part is His words influence you, and to get this word into manifestation, the Holy Spirit is there to help you. But if the word of God does not influence you and other people's word influence you, then the evil spirit is there to get forth the manifestation. So there's a choice. The Holy Ghost is in me and is willing to get into action, helping me. That's why he's called a helper. He doesn't do. He helps you to do.
Yes.
That's why he's called a?
Helper.
See, there is a person who wants to do the walk. Okay? He's the one who does everything. But there's a helper who will bring all the things. Mm-hmm. Or the helper does it. Mm-hmm. And that fellow watches.
No.
But what are we telling Holy Spirit? You do, I'll watch. He's like, no. I am your helper. You are the one who will do, I will help you. But most of our prayer is what? God, you please do it now. I am supposed to be your helper. Thank God, the light is on now.
Yes.
No, not that light. Hallelujah. Really, the ladies' Bible class is full of joy. What she said is really true. All the time smiling. Sorry? Your daughter will come at 12 o'clock? So you're indirectly telling me my time is up? You're telling me with love? That is what the ladies' class is all about. Telling things in a loving way, stop it. No, you did not say, but I understood that. Now you read between the lines. Praise God. And those who can't see, this lady, this sister, small sister, is only 90. How much?
95.
I don't believe it, but yet she keeps saying she's 95 years old. Certificate can be fair. She called her and said, come half an hour late. Okay. Every success or failure in a life, every success or failure in a life can be traced back to what? Come on, somebody fill in the blank.
Obedience.
Every success or failure in a life can be traced back to our honor or dishonor of the word. Every success or failure in a life can be traced back to our honor or dishonor of the word. Now, before we go any further, how many of you believe that prayer has the power to change your life? Come on.
Yes.
Prayer will change your life. change your life.
Prayer alone won't change your life.
Somebody said something.
Prayer alone won't change your life unless you make the decision, the choice.
So what will change your life?
To make the choice to do God's will.
So renewing our mind is what changes life. See, when you see people in trouble, what will the people say first?
Pray.
Pray, 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 pray. Will they say, come on, start honoring God's word? What is honoring God's word?
Pray.
Making God's word the superior and primary aspect of your life by being a doer of the word. Right? Now, let me give an example. I am praying, 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 but I am all the time angry. How will be my relationship with my spouse? I am praying, 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 but in my office I keep on taking bribe. How will be my situation? Are you following?
Yes.
So you can be a champion in praying, but when it comes to doing the word of God, you all the time fail. Your life will still be miserable. But if you are a person who is coming and renewing your mind, changing your thinking and living by the word of God, even if you are praying for 10 minutes, your life will still be awesome. Why? Because of your change of thinking. So which one is more important? Like, see, praying, 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 praying is like a student who is studying, 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 studying. But on the day of exam, writes all wrong answers. And the teacher has to give him full marks because he prayed the whole year. Because he studied the whole year. Will the teacher give him good marks?
No.
It's based on what he has written, the answers. So in our everyday life, now you came here for the Bible class. What did you learn today? Love those who? Correct?
Yes.
Correct? Now by the time you reach home, there is somebody who is waiting there to hate you. Okay? Now you learnt here and you said, love those who
hate you.
Now when the time came to love the one who hates you, you are hating again. Now, did you pass the test?
No.
So if you did not pass the test, did you get any reward?
No.
So what is very important in our life? Honoring God's word. So if you are in any kind of crisis, okay, and the crisis is going on getting worse and worse and worse, check out, am I a person who is honoring God's word or dishonoring God's word? Now somebody will say, you mean to say if I keep on honoring God's word, there will be no trouble in my life? Hey, there will be trouble. Like Joseph, he kept honoring God's word. Did his trouble increase?
Yes.
His brother sold him as slave. Then, when he got blessed, the Egyptian master wife tried to seduce him. Then, he was put in the prison. Then, he looked after the prisoners. One of the prisoners who was supposed to help him forgot it. So, every time you see negative, 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 negative. But in all that negative, did Joseph continue to honor?
Yes.
Now, when his time of blessing came, what did he become? Governor. So even in his lifetime labor, could he ever become a governor?
No.
But when you are going through unjust suffering or negative, 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 and you keep on honoring God's word, praise God, when the breakthrough comes, it will never be ordinary. It will be supernatural, extraordinary, beyond your capacity.
Amen.
Amen.
See, while getting something, clapping. That is God.
Amen.
All you mothers, did you all go through that 9 months?
Yes.
Did you go through that labor pain?
Yes.
Only after that you got your baby?
Yes.
Same thing God is saying. There is going to be 9 months pregnancy. There is going to be labor pain. And when the baby is about to come out, that's the time the mother goes through extreme complication, extreme pain, extreme thing. Because after that comes the baby, which she is going to enjoy all her life. In the same way, when you honor God, there's going to be pregnancy. There's going to be labor pain. But in all this thing, if you continue to honor, the baby that will come out will be extremely extraordinary blessing in your life. Father, thank you so much for today's message. Lord, you have spoken to each one, and all these mothers are extremely strong in many areas. They are much stronger than the husbands when it comes to pregnancy, when it comes to delivery, when it comes to labor pain, when it comes to looking after the children, when it comes to cooking. There are so many areas, O Lord, that you have made them extremely, extremely strong. But there are some areas, O Lord, where they fall again and again. Today you have shown us, O Father, that these are the areas where we need to strengthen ourselves by asking, by taking your word, honoring your word. And Holy Spirit, you are always with us, comforting us, strengthening us, teaching us new ways, new things, and helping us to put it into practice. Lord, today we have learned a very good lesson, that we got to love those who hate us. And then we are truly the children of the Most High God. Yes, Father. And in loving those who hate us, the reward is great, the blessings are great, the character is great, everything is great. You have put so many wonderful people in our life to train us to develop this character. From now on, we will no longer be focused on their change or their performance, but we will be only focusing on our performance to bring about change in our own character, in our own nature. We thank you and we praise you for this. In Jesus' name. Amen.